To review just a little bit from part one, we did a few things. It was the first part set out to expose the ramifications of the theory of Darwinian evolution and kind of expose the evils, kind of the world leaders and people of the influential figures that were influenced by the Darwinism and Darwin's Origin of Species book, people like Nietzsche and Hitler, Stalin, Trotsky, Mao, Pol Pot, Madison Grant and Margaret Sanger, the Planned Parenthood and eugenics people. So basically the deal is this, that kind of a Darwin theory, you've either got two worldviews that you're going to work from within. It'll be either the evolution and humanism, that man decides all truth, whether racism is right or wrong and murder is right and wrong and eugenics and euthanasia, or you've got another worldview, the creation worldview of God's truth. And if that's true, then God's word is true and God decides what's right and wrong. And you see the morality on the right side of the tree. And so basically there are worldviews in competition with this theory. Also, I kind of debunked the oxymoron of simple cell. We looked inside the cell and saw there's absolutely nothing simple inside the cell. There's just a flurry of activities, of integrated, coordinated activities there, over 600 different types of proteins in the average cell. Now, by doing some statistical analysis, we demonstrated the raw probability that it forbids the formation of not life, not a cell, but the building blocks of those 600 proteins, which are amino acid chains. By doing the math, just simple math that a middle schooler could do, we said that you multiply it out and get one chance in 10 to the 130th power, which is mathematically, according to many mathematicians, impossibility based on the number of molecules in the universe and the time involved and Planck's constants and different things. They don't just pull this number out of a hat. I said to really get one protein of 100 amino acids long form by just absolute chance, you'd have the same odds of winning the New Zealand Powerball lottery 17 weeks in a row. One in 38 million chance getting it 17 weeks in a row just to get the one protein. I finished off with Anthony Flew, the most notorious atheist kind of the last half of the last century, who, because of this information and the intelligent design movement, kind of flipped the script and went from saying there was no God to there is a God. Lastly, I talked about it makes a difference in terms. How is evolution defined? If evolution is just change, microevolution, change within a species, things get larger, smaller, the Galapagos finches, their beaks change shape, plumage changes color, etc. That's called microevolution within a species. No one debates that. The problem arises with macroevolution, changing from one species to another. We've yet to find an adequate process that can drive that, and I'll elaborate on that today. Now, I also talked about Darwin working with almost no knowledge of microbiology. He couldn't see inside the cell like we do. But he had absolutely no accurate knowledge of genetics and heredity. He never would have dreamed of the complexity of the genetic material we now know as called a DNA. DNA is called the fingerprint or the signature of God. Every living creature, every bacterial cell, every plant, animal, fungus, monera, whatever, every creature has its own DNA. Within humans, we're unique. Nobody has exactly the same DNA as you. It's like God's signature on his masterpiece, which is you. Now, DNA, I'll let a video, I'm gonna play a short video that talks briefly about DNA.
Like his grandfather Erasmus before him, Darwin supported a form of Lamarckism, a theory of hereditability developed by French biologist Jean-Baptiste Lamarck. It proposed that individual traits are passed through use and disuse. Why do giraffes have long necks? Lamarckians argued that when one giraffe stretched the size of its neck trying to find new food, it would develop a stronger and longer neck. That giraffe would have a baby giraffe, and the babies would then have stronger and longer necks. Today, this theory, an essential building block for Darwin's model of evolution, has been discredited. National Geographic magazine says that modern genetics turns the spotlight on his biggest mistakes. Darwin's own ideas on the mechanism of inheritance were a mess and wrong. Darwin's error was powerfully illustrated through the groundbreaking discovery of DNA. He knew life was complex, but he had no idea just how complex it was. DNA is a nucleic acid that houses genetic instructions, or blueprints. These blueprints are accessed during the growth and development of all known living things. It's what gives us our eye and hair color, our features. Everything about us is written in code, complex code. The human body contains about 2 tablespoons of DNA, and each DNA molecule is about 6 feet long, and it has been estimated that the entire amount in our 1 trillion cells would stretch back and forth to the moon 5,000 times. What's evident is this. For all living things on this planet, there is an incredibly complex code, more complex than any supercomputer on Earth. Yet this question persists. How could this massive amount of precise and detailed information contained in DNA come about by random chance and natural processes?
So a bit of an overview there. So DNA is very small, very tiny, very compact. A teaspoon, it's been postulated that a teaspoonful of DNA has enough information in it to code for every single protein of every single organism in the history of the supposed Earth, the age of the Earth, whatever that might be, and code for every book ever written. Our human DNA, it has 3 billion base pairs. It's equivalent to about 32 gigs of information. If it were written out in a book or text, single space, 12 font, it would be 5 million pages, a book of 5 million pages. If you read it every second of your life, it'd take you 37 years to get through all that information. Bill Gates, who knows a little bit about information and codes, he said this. He said, DNA is like a computer program, but far, far more advanced than any software ever created. Now, we know that every single computer program like this, every software code has a designer behind it. It's common sense, right? DNA has to control everything the cell does. You started out as a single fertilized cell, and now you're trillions of you. So that in that first fertilized egg, that first zygote, had to have all the information about your life, how to develop arms and legs and hearts and kidneys and everything else, and even the aging process and losing your hair, unfortunately, all these things, how to reproduce and divide, and all of it had to be coded in that DNA. Imagine for what you would need to do if it was your responsibility to code for this car, the manufacturer of this car. You would have to code for how to design the tires exactly and the rims exactly and make sure there's lubricants and integrate that with the axle system, which is lubricated, which is connected to the internal combustion engine, which is connected to the electrical system and the spark wiring and nowadays computer programs. It all has to be in place. And if you get the coding wrong, you end up with something that's not like this Flash 240Z, but something that looks more like this 40Z, a bit of a wreck there. Now, living organisms, we talked about a car, a flash car, but living organisms, all of them far surpass an automobile and what would be necessary for that. Can an automobile heal itself? If I scrape myself here, it'll heal up in a day or two or whatever. I can metabolize and take in energy and reproduce. My cells reproduce. We can do lots of things that a car can't. I used to say, we can drive ourselves, but thanks to Google can drive. Cars can drive themselves now. But we're still magnitudes. Life is still magnitudes ahead of things that we can produce by automation and whatnot. So we know where the information in the cell is. We know where it's located, but the obvious question is, where did that information in the DNA come from? Now, this question is not just for original life, the first cell, as some would like you to believe. We don't know where life came from, but once you give us life, evolution takes over. That's not true. Every time you change a protein, you need more information. Every time you tweak a system, you need information. Every time you go from one species to the next, no matter how slowly or gradually, you need information. I don't care if you're getting Shakespeare's volume a word at a time, you still have to have the right word at a time, right? And so that's a nagging problem for the theory. And questions that don't get adequately answered, well, they just don't go away. It's like the Santa Claus question, you know, a five-year-old, you can tell them Santa Claus comes down the chimney, et cetera, but when they get a little older, well, hang on, we don't have a chimney. Well, you've got to begin to have ad hoc and contrived arguments if you want to keep the gig going. Well, if you don't have a chimney, he gets through the door. Well, what if it's locked? Well, he has a skeleton key, one for every house in the universe, even automated, automatic, electronic, and on it goes. That's called being contrived. You're making up or ad hoc an argument as it goes. And I feel that's the way it goes when trying to explain where information comes from. I'll tell you what I mean in just a minute. So the materialist answers, a materialist, at least can't, an atheist, their answers, I'll give you three possibilities. The first one is that it organized the DNA, the information in the DNA organized itself by random chance. The naturalist, the atheist argues that, well, we see examples in nature of self-organization, things that have patterns like the concentric rings of a water drop, right? Okay, can't argue with that. That's true. Or a vortex swirling down a thing, or snowflakes or ice crystals or salt crystals or whatever. We see this for spontaneous formation of patterns, right? And so therefore they say DNA could self-organize, they say. But simple order and simple repeating patterns is not the same at all as functional information. It's technically called specified complexity. It's non-repeating. It's aperiodic information bearing. It's the difference between, you know, throwing Scrabble pieces down and forming the word at versus, you know, a big long sentence. This is the microevolution, macroevolution distinction. Well, we can form snowflakes and crystals. Therefore, information and DNA must just be able to form spontaneously. Now, you may not understand the technical terms, but your intuition tells you this is true. It tells you that the above examples I just gave in nature are acceptable. But nature would never produce the waves and the tides of the ocean wouldn't produce a sandcastle. You would know that. The weather and elements and rain and erosion wouldn't produce the faces on Mount Rushmore, is it? Mount Rushmore there. Mount Rushmore. A young child might be fooled into thinking, wow, dryer went off and look, the clothing is folded, right? But not an adult who's actually taken the time, energy, and effort to fold those clothes. Now, proponents of chance, they argue that even the information in the works of Shakespeare, William Shakespeare, could be produced by chance given enough time. They claim that given if you had enough monkeys typing for long enough, they would eventually produce the works of William Shakespeare. Well, I Googled this. Wikipedia had a bit of an article on it, and Wikipedia is no friend to Christianity or theism. Here's what Wikipedia says. It says, if there were as many monkeys as there were particles in the observable universe, that's like 10 to the 80th, and each monkey typed 1,000 keystrokes per second, okay, your keyboard would be on fire from the friction, but let's go with it. And they did this for 100 times the a life of the universe. In other words, 1.3 trillion years, not the 13.7 billion. Their conclusion, the probability of the monkeys replicating even a short book is nearly zero. So don't get trapped into thinking, oh, we just don't understand big time. We can crunch the numbers and figure it out. Remember, DNA is 5 million pages worth of information, and we don't have as much DNA as some other organisms do. So in the observable world, that's what science is observation. Information does not ever come from random chance processes. So the first theory is it's just a lucky information that just came from randomness, but we pretty much debunked that. The second hypothesis is that crystals helped organize it. Now, I need to qualify this guy because I'm going to play a video. His name's Michael Roos. He's not a drunk off the street. He's got an earned PhD and three honorary doctorates. He's a fellow of the Royal Society of Canada and the United States, the American Association of Science. He was an expert witness in the McLean versus Arkansas creation evolution debate. So he's somebody. This is when Ben Stein interviews him and says, where did the information in DNA come from? Well, how did DNA get there?
How did we get from an inorganic world to the world of the cell?
Well, one popular theory is that it might have started off on the backs of crystals.
My crystal ball.
Molecules piggybacked on the back of crystals forming, and that this led to more and more complex. But of course, the nice thing about crystals is every now and then you get mistakes, mutations, and that this opens the way for natural selection.
But at one point there was not a living thing.
Yeah.
And then there was a living thing. How did that happen?
Well, this is I've just told you. And I don't see any reason why you shouldn't go from very simple to more and more complex to more and more complex.
I don't either, but I don't know how you get from mud to a living cell. That's my question.
Yes, well, I've told you.
On the backs of crystals.
On the backs of crystals is at least one hypothesis, yes.
So that's your theory, and you think that is more likely and less far-fetched than intelligent design?
I think it is.
There you have it, from the horse's mouth. He's not talking about a crystal ball. He's talking about clay crystals. This is an electron micrograph of clay crystals. And, you know, I don't have the advanced degrees that he does, but I'd like to look him right in the eye and say, are you joking me? I see at least three major problems with this crystals hypothesis. The first one being is this. DNA is much smaller than the clay crystal. It's too small to fit in between the cracks. And there's a difference between a placeholder for DNA and the source of information for DNA. For instance, you get a six-month-old and you give them just 11 alphabet blocks. You scramble them out there, go for it, Junior. You come back in the room, it says, I love you, Mom. Now, if you're gullible, you might think, well, look what happened there. Because, you know, 6 months old, they're just drooling and barely lifting things. But if you knew the odds against it, you'd know something was going on. To form this, just with these 11 letters, you've got all the right letters to begin with. It's one chance in 40 million. And a whole alphabet of letters and an infinite number of letters, the chance would be one in 100 trillion. Well, let's go with this one. One chance in 40 million. And so Mom should be looking, okay, where's Daddy hiding? Where's the intelligent source hiding? But here's the thing. Oh, no, you don't understand. Junior had an egg crate. See, he just put little letters in each of the little holes there. That's what organized it. Pause. That might tell you why they're in a nice sequential line, but that still absolutely has a chance of one chance in 40 million from happening, because you've got to have them in the right order. The clay crystals would provide places for the DNA, the backbone, the sugar phosphate backbone to line up, but you got to get them in the right order. So that's pretty busted on that one. The third thing I'd like to say about this problem is it doesn't solve the problem of a decoder. Let me tell you what I mean. Let me show you the most meaningful sentence that was ever conceived. Here it is. Most important meaningful sentence and phrase that's ever been devised. And you might think, well, I don't get it. Well, it's because you don't read Swahili. Translated into English, it is John chapter 3, verse 16. For God loved the world so much that he gave his one and only son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish, but have eternal life. So you need to be able to decode information. To say that a coded message of DNA arose by chance is not sufficient enough. Here's your code of DNA. I mean, for the most of you, if I told you that DNA read GCA, ATT, GCA, it would look like the Swahili. What are you talking about? That means nothing to me. Well, you don't understand the cellular translation and transcription and what's going on there. That's actually a coded message there. To say that this came from chance would be like saying this, okay, Jeff, I'm going to blindfold myself and create a secret code. you down there in Dunedin, you blindfold yourself. We won't communicate together, but you build something that'll decode my secret code. And then we'll get together and this will all work out just fine. That A, I'm going to be able to make a secret code by chance blindly. And B, that you're going to be able to build a decoder to understand what I say. And it's just not going to work that way. Remember, questions that don't have adequate answers, they don't go away. It's like the Santa Claus. It gets more elaborate and contrived. The third possibility is proposed by a very famous scientist. This is James Watson and Francis Crick, who's on the right. They discovered the shape of the spiral DNA. There was a race to do so, and they were the first in 1953. They won a Nobel Prize for their work with nucleic acids in 1962. Now, Francis Crick on the right, before they did this work, he was a code breaker in World War II. He knew it about information, he knew about codes, and he was trying to break Hitler's code, the Nazis' code. He knew about codes and information. When they discovered what was going on in that spiral helix, he said, this is a digital code. This is information. He said, information comes from intelligent sources. And so he said, you know, I can only come to the conclusion that there must be a God. No, sorry, he didn't say that. He said it must have come from outer space, from aliens. I kid you not. This wasn't something he said while drunk in a bar and somebody had an MP3 recorder. Of course, they weren't around back then. No, they wrote a book about it, him and Leslie Orgel in 1973. He reaffirmed it in his 1983 book, Life Himself, and Life Itself, in another interview in 1992 with Scientific America. He really believes this thing. Even if this were the case, it would do two things. It would only defer the question to another location in the cosmos, but it would also admit there was intelligence behind it all. I think he's been deluded. I agree with G.K. Chesterton, who said, when a man stops believing in God, he is not believing nothing, he believes anything. Anything but God, that is. Anything but God. Aliens, maybe. I told you last time about the Royal Society in 2016. They had a big conference, very prestigious conference, the Royal Society Conference. They were talking about the new trends in evolution and the five persistent problems with Neo-Darwinian theory. Neo-Darwinian just means it's now got genetics involved. They were looking for what was called a third way for the information. They knew that information didn't come from chance and it wasn't due to physical necessity. The DNA didn't just have to land in the egg crates like they did to make a message. During the presentation of one of the attending professors, Professor Nancy Cartwright, she was proposing kind of a higher principal agency must have been involved. She could see the tension rising. She could see the apprehension because of the implications of where she was going. So she stopped her speech and said, look, she wasn't a Christian or anything. She said, look, I'm not talking about God. We can talk about aliens. We can talk about spontaneous information coming, but no, we can't talk about the G word. Atheists for a long time have accused Christians of arguing from a lack of evidence. They call it the God of the gaps argument. Supposedly we say, we don't know how the universe came into being, so it must have been God. We don't know how proteins might have organized themselves together, so it must have been God. But I would argue that we're drawing conclusions for a creator from the information we do have, not from the information that we don't have. We do know that working within the laws of observation in our universe, that matter doesn't naturally pop into existence from nothing. We need a supernatural event, creator or something. Matter doesn't organize itself to the fine-tuned degrees that we see it all by itself. We need something else happening there. Information only ever comes from an intelligent source. That's arguing from what we know, not from what we don't know. We're drawing an inference to the best conclusion based on the information we have. Another positive argument originating from what we do know is termed the intelligent design argument. Now, intelligent design is this. It's the argument that many structures found in living organisms are so efficiently and effectively designed that there had to be an intelligent being doing the designing and are not the product of unguided random chance events. Richard Dawkins says, biology is the study of complicated things that have the appearance of having been designed for a purpose. appearance. In other words, what we're looking at, what we see with our own eyes. Most intelligent design proponents are engineers, they're structural or mechanical or software or electrical engineers. They're professors of engineering in universities, and they've studied, their studies have enabled them to identify design, either poor design or good design. Now, I'm going to propose or introduce some evidence for special intelligent design in kind of an unlikely candidate. You'll be a bit unimpressed at first if you haven't seen this. What you're looking at is an E. coli bacteria. It's a gram-negative bacteria, not even discovered until 1885 when we had microscopes strong enough to do so. Now, what's absolutely the evolutionary stumper is what's too small to be seen here. It's a small motor called a Kinesin motor, which drives those tails. Those tails aren't just floating freely in fluid. They're being driven. Here's what it looks like. Engineers say bees have design. They've got a U-joint and bushings, a drive shaft, a rotor stator. They've got a hook. They're water cooled. They've got forward and reverse gears. They've got proton motive force. And they've been clocked at 100,000 revolutions per minute. You talk about efficient machine. If we could do that, we'd be able to move, to swim through liquid at like, I think it is 120 feet per second. It's just incredible what that does. Now, we can't come close to this kind of nanotechnology. Some scientists and engineers spend their whole careers trying to do so. This thing's only 40 nanometers across. Our a human hair, if I had need to show you, is about 100 to 200,000 nanometers across. There's a doctor, Dr. James Tour. He's ranked in the top 10 chemists of the world for the past decade. He's got his PhD in organic chemistry, and he teaches synthetic organic technology at Rice University. He's won multiple international awards, recognitions, and even competitions. There was an international competition to build a nano car, a molecular car. That's his molecular car. It's made of molecules, and it drives itself across very slowly, but it drives itself across a gold foil sheet. He knows about synthesizing. It took the team 8 years to get this car to crawl at a snail's pace across gold foil. Now, I found a quote from him just yesterday in preparing for this. I love what he said. Again, one of the best synthetic, in other words, he makes things, synthetic organic chemists in the world. He said, we have no idea how the basic set of molecules, carbohydrates, nucleic acids, lipids, and proteins were made, and how they could have coupled in proper sequences and then transformed into the ordered assemblies until there was a construction of a complex biological system, and eventually to that first cell. Nobody has any idea on how this was done when using our commonly understood mechanisms of chemical science. Those that say they understand are generally wholly uninformed regarding chemical synthesis. Those that say, oh, this is well worked out, they know nothing, nothing about chemical synthesis, nothing. It's one of the top 10 chemists of the world that knows about, they Google him, it's pretty interesting. So the flagellar motor seems not only, it screams design at us, but it also is befitting of an intelligent source, but it also displays a property called irreducible complexity. Big term, but what it basically means is this, that flagellar motor that you saw spinning around is pretty much as simple as it can be. It's irreducible in its complexity. It can't get any simpler. A common example is a mouse trap. Michael Behe uses this as an example. The mouse trap is good at catching mice, but it is as simple as it can be. If you take away any of the parts in this mouse trap, function is lost. It will no longer snap on cue to get a mouse like that. And remember that if that's as simple as it can get, then you can't, if you're building it up one piece at a time, you won't have function until it's all complete. Now, Darwin himself, he recognized the ramifications of organs and systems whose existence couldn't be accounted by slow, gradual steps. He said this, that if it could be demonstrated any complex organ existed which could not possibly have been formed by numerous successive slight modifications, my theory would break down. Well, it's been demonstrated. So your theory is pretty much broken, Charles. Why? Again, because according to Darwinian evolutionary theory, each step, each change has to be something functional and something positive. Otherwise, nature is not going to keep it. Natural selection only keeps things that are beneficial every single step along the way. Every single step. Evolution culls things that are not beneficial or if they're harmful. Evolution is not, it's not patient and it's not forward planning. It doesn't say, oh, just two more steps and we're there. There's numerous examples, but it's kind of like a combination lock. Somebody puts the seismic combination lock and scrambles it all together, right? You cannot open this if you don't know the combination. If you weren't paying attention when it first was there, if you don't know the combination, you can't open it step by step. As a matter of fact, even if you got three of the four numbers right, and the last one needs just one more click, it does you absolutely no good. That lock won't budge until they're all lined up. That's irreducibly complex. That combination is irreducibly complex. You can't get there. It'd be nice to pick a lock if you've got one number right and it clicked a little bit. You got another number right and it clicked a little bit. That's the way Darwinian evolution must advance. But the flagellar motor, the flagella motor is irreducibly complex. You can't take pieces out of it and get any function whatsoever. There's numerous things like this, such as the blood clotting system. To get a blood clot so you don't bleed to death, a scab, there is a cascade of 12 different proteins that have to act and interact with one another. Take one of them out and it doesn't work. People with hemophilia, bleeder's disease, that they can't stop bleeding. There's just one deficient protein, an anti-hemophilic factor. The optical system of the eyes. Darwin, he said this, to suppose that the eye could have been formed by natural selection seems, I freely confess, absurd in the highest degree. I mean, the retina of the eye, just in 6 square centimeters, contains 137 million light-sensitive cells. How could you get that to form a little at a time with the focusing and all this? But recall, but the eye is not the only thing needed to complete the system. A perfectly wonderful eye is absolutely no good until you've got an optic nerve that connects it to the visual cortex, a part of the brain, which has been evolved enough, if you will, to be able to interpret that and unscramble the upside down sideways images to do so. I've heard Richard Dawkins online try and explain the evolution of the eyeball, and coming from a biology background, it sounded pretty ad hoc, pretty contrived, pretty much like trying to convince Santa Claus to a teenager at that even. Kind of the coolest and most fun example of irreducibly complex system is that found in a creature called the bombardier beetle.
This beetle is a walking powder keg. That cloud you see is the result of a lightning fast chemical reaction inside his body. When attacked, the beetle sets off the explosion, releasing a boiling hot stinging poison that sends his enemies running. He can even aim it. This potent mixture inside the beetle is made up of three main ingredients. Mix the first two of them together and nothing happens, but throw in the third and boom. So the beetle has a trick. He keeps these ingredients separate inside his body. From an evolutionary standpoint, that's what's interesting. In fact, people have been scratching their heads over this for decades. How did this complex system evolve over time? Wouldn't earlier generations of beetles have blown themselves up like a bunch of amateur bomb makers? To some, this beetle's very survival is proof that the whole theory of evolution is wrong.
Yes, and she goes on to try and explain it away, but I listened to her explanation, and again, it's pretty ad hoc and contrived. It's no good until it's complete. And it's also lethal and destructive until you've got your inhibitors that'll inhibit the hydroquinones and hydrogen peroxides and the oxidative agents. It's all got to be there together before it's in a bit, you know, beneficial, but it's also very harmful and detrimental. Now, I've held back on touching on probably the biggest problem for the theory of evolution, and that is the fossil record, specifically the lack of transitional fossils. Darwin said this, he said, if my theory, that is about slow, gradual evolution, be true, numberless intermediate varieties must surely have existed. In other words, going from the fish, the amphibians, the reptiles, to the birds, should have taken a very, very, very long, long, long time, and having everything in between the A to Z there. Now, they were absent in the time of Charles Darwin, but he was convinced, he was aware of the Cambrian explosion, where 20 phyla of organisms popped into existence in just about 10 million years, which is a blip of time, evolutionarily speaking. He was aware of the Cambrian explosion and other problems, and he thought time would reveal these missing fossils. But the question is, have they? Textbooks give kind of the misimpression that they have most of the fossil record figured out, kind of like a puzzle with a few pieces. We can sense what's missing there. But the reality is the puzzle looks a bit more like this, and the rest is an extrapolation of imagination, to be honest. They're conspicuously absent in predicted location. What do all the missing links have in common? They're all missing. They're all missing. There's no fossils representing the transition from invertebrates to vertebrates, the jellyfish to the fish themselves. There's no ancestors to the fish, and it supposedly took 100 million years to get there. There's no transition from the fish to the amphibians, which supposedly took 30 million years to happen. But just not take my word for it. Let's hear from the experts. Let me go back for a second. British Museum of Natural History has the largest fossil collection in all of Europe. The museum's curator, his name was, and senior paleontologist, Dr. Colin Patterson. He had written a book about evolution. When Patterson was asked why he didn't show any missing fossil links in the book, he responded thusly, "I fully agree with your comment on the lack of evolutionary transitions in my book. If I knew of any, fossil or living, I would certainly have included them. I will lay it on the line. There is not one such fossil. I've been there. In part one, you would have seen me on the steps of the Museum of Natural History with the marble Darwin. I've been there, quite unimpressed. Big exhibits on at the evolutionary theory and human evolution, but scant evidence. Lots of artist reconstructions and maybe one bone, and they build it from there up, like the puzzle pieces of the dinosaur. The Field Museum of Natural History in Chicago, Illinois, is the world's largest collection of fossils. When its curator, Dr. David Ropp, was asked about Darwin's missing fossils, he had this to say. Remember, more fossils than anyone in the world. He said, "Well, we're now about 120 years after Darwin, and knowledge of the fossil record has been greatly expanded. We now have 250,000 fossil species, but the situation hasn't changed much. The record of evolution is still surprisingly jerky, and ironically, we have even fewer examples of evolutionary transition than we had in Darwin's time." Again, more fossils collected than anyone in the world there. If the process of evolution was a slow and gradual, as proponents claim, then there should be an absolute abundance of fossils out there. Now, lack of transitional fossils was one of the five problems of the evolutionary theory that the Royal Society was discussing in 2016, amongst other things. The late Dr. Stephen Jay Gould, he was a noted paleontologist and evolutionary biologist. He taught at Harvard University and wrote books. He said this, he said, "The absence of fossil evidence for intermediary stages has been a persistent and nagging problem for evolution." Now, in response to the lacking evidence of slow, gradual change and not leaving fossils behind, Gould and a guy named Niles Eldridge came up with a modified theory of evolution called punctuated equilibrium. Evolution didn't happen so slow, leaving all these fossils. It happened so fast in jumps that there wasn't time to leave fossils behind, a jumping sequence. Richard Goldsmith in the 1940s talked about the hopeful monster theory. In other words, these two-eyed beasts wake up and, hey, somebody's got a third eye there. And a cartoonist, diagrammed it as this, that a reptile lays an egg and out comes a bird. Evolution happened so fast that it couldn't leave a fossil record behind. There's no evidence for this. There's no mechanism to drive this. We don't see it happening today. And little, if anybody that I know of, really goes for this theory. But again, it's like the Santa Claus scenario. We got the explanations become more ad hoc and more contrived and more ridiculous sounding. So I think there's delusion going on there. It's been 150 plus years since the Darwin origin of species. Where are these fossils? They're still nowhere to be seen. Science is supposed to be about observation. Stephen Jay Gould, the guy I just spoke of, he notes that the fossil record, it shows two things. When we see fossils, we see all animals as complete when we first see them. We don't see animals that look like they're on their way to something. We don't see animals, insects, plants that have parts hanging out, sticking out with no function at all. The second thing that they seem to show is that they're unchanging over time. Bees still look like bees, and crayfish like crayfish, and lemurs like lemurs. And this is what you would think if the Genesis account, if the creative account were true. Five facts about transitional fossils. One, they're very few and far between. Okay, we don't have very many. About 250,000 fossil species are supposedly intermediate out of the literally billions of organisms that would have had to live had this happened. About 1% of the fossils we have, like my puzzle. Two, they're often anachronistic. In other words, they're out of order. What I mean by that is this: they found a fossil. They termed it Archaeopteryx. Supposedly, Archaeopteryx was a reptile, a dinosaur, if you will, on his way being a bird, a flighted bird. The problem with that is they dated the Archaeopteryx older or earlier than the dinosaurs that it supposedly arose from. The same thing happened with the Tiktaalik. You can Google that, Tiktaalik, anachronistic. Third thing, they're highly debated. All these transitional fossils are highly debated and controversial, even amongst the naturalist paleontologists. They argue about how old it is and the significance of it is. The fourth thing, they have a shelf life of about 10 years or so before they're overturned as being accurate. I'm speaking in generalities, but we've seen it. For instance, this fish, or whatever it was, well, it is a fish, the coelacanth. The coelacanth was touted as a fish amphibian transition. This was a fish transitioning into an amphibian because of its thick lobes. They thought these are almost like legs. I'll bet it could, was ready to pop off onto the land there. It was probably a surface dwelling fish. They said it went extinct 70 million years ago. Problem is, in 1938, off the coast of Madagascar, they find a living coelacanth. Pretty embarrassing for three reasons. One, it was not extinct, obviously. Two, it was 100% fish, not amphibian. It had no amphibious characteristics. And three, it wasn't even a surface fish. It was a deeper water fish. So when we find bones of dead things, it tells us one thing, that something died. You've got to extrapolate or interpolate or read into the data. So when two people see fossils, they can have very different, based on their worldview, their pre-assumptions, they might come to very drastic conclusions. And fifth, in regarding transitional fossils, in many cases, they would pose a very huge problem for the evolutionary survival of the organisms. Now, recall that every single change has to be beneficial. The organism must be benefited for its survival. And the common example they show is the giraffe that we saw in the video earlier, that the longer the necks of the giraffes got, the more fit they were. They could survive by eating vegetation that was higher in the canopy, in the tree canopy there. And so that's a very common example. And it seems quite logical, other than the problem that there's not a clear-cut fossil record showing that. But in many cases, what you would have, these transitions would be detrimental. For instance, a transition from being reptile to bird, something that's crawling to something that's flying, supposedly took 65 million years. These very transitional creatures would actually be quite problematic to the theory. Think about this. This guy, 2 million years away from flying, actually flying, but he's got these wings that are almost there, right? He is going to be the first thing to get eaten by whatever's going to try and predate on him. He's going to be the last thing to catch and capture its prey. This would be a disadvantage. Remember, natural selection culls off organisms. It's not patient and it's not forward planning. Almost there is not good enough. If you're slowest to catch your food, you're going to die off. And this problem is not just true on a species or an organism level. This is true of the molecular level. The proteins I was talking about yesterday, to get one protein to transform into another, same thing's got to occur. You've got to change amino acids and retain function along the way. Otherwise, the cell is going to scrap that. Evolution is going to scrap that at the molecular level. A couple of recommended readings, Cons of Evolution, Bones of Contention, and something I read a few years ago. It's a bit of a big book, but I really like it. I'll try and get the glaze out. It's called Darwin's Doubt. It's by Stephen C. Myers. And I'm very impressed with this scholarly gentleman. He started the Discovery Institute. He's actually been to the Burgess Shale in Canada and interviewed people and talked with people. So he knows what he's talking about. And he really goes into the Cambrian explosion and the problems that is formed. So in concluding the series, I kind of want to challenge you to examine current evidence, right? Evolution was not visible in the past by the fossil record, right? Organisms are fully formed and unchanged over time. We saw that. That's what Stephen Jay Gould said about it. But what about the present? If evolution is supposedly an ongoing process, if evolution is our hero, our God, our savior that got us to be where we are today, according to some, isn't it still in progress today? Or did it stop with modern scientific men for some strange reason? I would say no. So if evolution is a blind and random process, which Kenneth Miller, the author of many high school and university textbooks, says, Kenneth Miller says, evolution works without plan or purpose. And he says the living world is constantly evolving without any goals. Evolutionary change is not directed. That's what he says. Textbook writer, very famous one. Now, if organs take eons to build and all organisms kind of borrowed parts from others, then I would think that some organisms we see should look kind of like the car I showed earlier. Oh, look, there's a heater blower on top. We just got to relocate that, but it's functional. We got a steering wheel out the back there, but you know, it's good enough. You could drive back there. It'd be funny. You've got a wheel underneath the car. Huh, that'll have to migrate over time to the back there. But at least we got three wheels and we can drag that along until evolution has time to spiff it up a bit. We'd see things kind of analogous to that. If there were parts from other organisms, I would think it'd be kind of like this bicycle that you see that's got a rake for the handlebars and a spigot up top. And hey, it doesn't look like much, but it works. It's functional. Reminds me of my middle school science projects, you know, the old Rube Goldberg machines to crack an egg using as many machines as you can, a screw and a lever and all these things. It looked terrible, but it cracked the egg at the end. That's all evolution cares about. Why isn't anything at that stage that we see right now? Why don't we see the hopeful monsters of the you know, Richard Goldbergs? Now, what would you expect at least some organisms to look like? The junkyard, the bicycle, but what do we observe out there in nature? Well, let me remind you of what we do observe. So God created the great creatures of the ocean. He created every living and moving thing that fills the waters. He created all kinds of them. He created every kind of bird that flies. And God saw that it was good. God made all kinds of water. He made all kinds of livestock. He made all kinds of creatures that move along the ground. And God saw it was good. God said, let us make man in our image and likeness. To rule over the fish, the waters, and the birds of the air. But to rule over the livestock, the birds. And God saw everything he had made, and it was very good. It was evening, and it was morning. Thank you. So why is every creature we find today, it's complete, not lacking anything, and having no extra parts? They used to talk about vestigial organs in the humans. There was 120 things in humans that were leftovers of evolution. I think the appendix was the last thing they took off of that list, saying, oh, no, it actually does have a function on it. Why don't we see that, right? Why is everything functioning in integrated systems and parts instead of half-formed ones? And everything's not just complete and functional, but beautiful. Well, look at the shell on that thing. It's a beautiful creature, right? Because God said it was good and very good. I would say life looks a lot less like this crazy bike or this crazy car, but more like Z car zipping down the road, sleek at 100K an hour. Now, to sum up, evolution as per Darwinian definition, we've gone somewhere today in the last meeting. It has some very dangerous social ramifications, right? Sanger, Grant, Stalin, Hitler, Mao. It's statistically not just improbable, but impossible, okay? The math is just too unlikely. It's fraught with problems like the origin of information and irreducibly complex systems and structures. It's unsubstantiated by the fossil evidence, especially the Cambrian to the Cambrian explosion, the discontinuity there. And then lastly, it's much disconfirmed by current everyday observation. You and I and everything around us just screams that we were created by a loving God, that you were made with a purpose and for a purpose. Every person on the planet has infinite intrinsic value to God. And perhaps you're listening, you've never been convinced of this. You believe the lie that you're just a product of lucky mud with no purpose in life. Perhaps what I've said to you kind of starting to make sense and say, hey, yeah, we couldn't have got there through this neo-Darwinian godless atheist theory. So what? Well, it's the so what has been the most impactful and meaningful thing in my life. It's this getting to know God through Jesus Christ, his will for my life, his plan for my life. This has given my life purpose and meaning and hope and joy. And my goal is that it sparked that desire in you. And that relationship with God is found through his son, Jesus Christ. So that concludes the Darwin Delusion part one and part two. There might be many, many questions. Let me throw up a slide with some links, like what about the dinosaurs? And is the earth millions of years old or relatively young? Or was there really a great global flood? A young earth creation, a couple of sites. Old earth creations, people that believe that the earth is very old. Notice I didn't really get into that at all. And then maybe a side-by-side comparison of evidences for a young earth and an old earth there and scientific clocks. Just a few ideas. We will, I'll throw out my PowerPoint deck. We'll get that to you, but this will be online. You can go back to it. So that does me